Tonight, we reach the halfway stage and see how far Frieda Rees, Joe Connor and Louise Weston have come. With the help of Ian's star guests, we find out how a song doesn't need to be loud to be lovely, and we join the class as Ian begins some new vocal exercises.
Tonight we're going into what I call double octaves. This is very much using as well the fact that the sound must be in the cathedral part here and not in the lower part of the mouth, and beginning and going through, opening the jaw, opening the mouth for the top, closing a little on the way through to retain it in the higher part. Sharon, you might do this for me, would you? Ah. Very good indeed. And very nice. You see, she's got a wonderful mouth to show all this off with. That's wonderful. Now, we're going to use the vowels tonight. I've begun with R's. Only R's before. Tonight I'm going to add the rest of the vowels, Italian vowels, R, A, E, O, U. And I always work from R to A to E to U, because those two closed vowels are then together. But if you find that perhaps some people find an E and an U easier to sing, then use that and go from E to A and U to O, and use that. I know a lot of you are very interested in amateur groups and various things, and I think you'll find that very helpful. I'm going to ask Joe and Drew to do on A, the next one up. A. A. Uh-huh, it's very low, but you know, there's no reason for not being able to get down there. But the great secret of getting down there is to do hey, and you change the jaw so that it becomes here. Hey, and not hey, or trying to find it. All the tenors you'll think are basses, and all the basses you'll think are tenors with these exercises, and I believe that's the easy way of singing. The relationship of your voice, you may have the facht of having a baritone, tenor, or soprano, whatever the case may be, but you can always improve your range. Let's go on to the E now, and Louise and Frieda will do this for you, E. Very good, all together now, ooh. Ooh. And if you all wonder why I'm doing that trill there, which is the word for the ooh, that is actually to take away the tension of the voice. Very often trills are before a high note. I put it there in the middle so that you can't push to go down. If you're in focus with the trill, let's do O, carrying on. O. Great improvement going on. Ah, on your own here. Ah. Very good. Now all together, A. Very good indeed. Now, we're going to move on to the next exercise, but before doing it, I would like to just ask Janet to do something for me in the piano here. The harmonics of the piano will show themselves up, and then I'll explain the exercise to you.
Okay. So if I just put down a chord, you will hear some notes above it, which I won't play. It will be a sympathetic vibration from the harmony. Okay.
Can you all hear that? Mm-hmm. Now, the piano's overstrung to give this effect, but we have in our apparatus this wonderful little voice box we've got. We have stretching muscles and anchoring muscles to the vocal cords, which can create the same thing. People try and put on vibrato in their voice, particularly pop singers. No disrespect, Louise. And they're at the mercy of so much then. But I believe in coming in from the top of the voice and coming through the voice. Here I've got a rather complicated exercise, chromatic with an added sixth, and then going back in the tonic, which is a bit of a cheat to make you think you've gone higher. You haven't. But I'll just show you if Janet plays it. It's... Yeah? Now, there's no pressure in that, and you've mixed through the voice and used the bottom of the voice and come back. We're all going to do it together, because they've been battling with this at home. But they've been doing very well. Let's go. Ah. Very nice. Now, Frida, on your own, A. You could leave your mouth open when you finish, darling one, but it's wonderful. Now we're going to move straight along and do double octave ninth exercise, which is for speed in the voice. Speed is very important in the voice, as Joe's been finding out with his song, that you've got to have this quick ability in the voice. So here, I'm going to ask Joe to do this one for you. Ah. Very good indeed. Now, all let's join A. And the audience, please, we're all part of this experience. Let's try it together. A. And if you do watch how cleverly all these students now, and Sharon and Drue, are not doing this or this with the voice when they go down, they're lifting up and being in the mask of the face. Now, we've been working here, as you've seen, and my students and all my pupils work that same way at home. It's very important if we're going to improve our singing technique. People do it until they're 80. There's no reason that we should not be working extremely hard, always at home, finding out. And my three new students have been doing just that.
You know, when you have to come down or go up through a lot of notes altogether, runs I've found very difficult. And Ian, I can't remember the word that he used for it. He was very polite, but he I think he felt that I was a bit sort of in a rut set, and he's wanted to free the voice. And the runs in particular have helped in that respect, but they are difficult. Says to people, feel me, feel my stomach or abdomen or whatever. And you tend to think that's a bit silly, really. You think, well, it doesn't make any difference. But actually, it does. And this at this last lesson, last weekend, he got the accompanist. He said, Ian played the piano, and he said, feel while, I can't remember his name, while he sings this scale or whatever. And it really made a difference. And I've obviously been using muscles here that I've never used before, or certainly haven't used for years, because I've been really sore here, across the middle. And it's obviously from using muscles, as I say, that I've never used before.
Ian has helped a lot. He's helped me to sing the songs a lot stronger and put more into it. So I still feel the same. You know, it's going to be good, hopefully.
Closer,
Omi Ababina Caro. It's taught me to project my voice a lot more, especially with a lot of the, because in the actual opera song it goes very high and very low in certain areas, and I never ever thought in a million years I would be able to sing a song like that, because it's just not my type of song, and it's just, it's hard to explain really, it's just completely helped. I didn't think it would, but when I've actually come back to singing my rock and roll, there's a definite difference, for sure. I feel much more stronger and able to reach the notes without any problem at all.
There are times when you feel, is this going to be a little bit out of my reach? For example, Bring Him Home, I'm now taking up a tone, but I know that I'm still not hitting the high notes as I would like, or I'm even struggling to get them. That's quite daunting and a little dissuading, a little discouraging. And you sometimes feel, you know, why can't I just be that little bit more exceptional and get that? If I think of it in those terms, I can sometimes get a little bit down, and I really, really want to go on there and sing way above myself, which I'm not capable of doing yet.
A lot of care should be taken with that exercise.
The best moment throughout the whole of the training, I felt, is the point where I suddenly realised the tuition was coming together and I felt the range of the voice was starting to increase. I've never had a tremendous range. I've always wanted to have, because it's very restrictive not to have a big range. I think now that is starting to come through, so I'll be able to take on harder parts, things like Frederick in Pirates of Penzance, which will be coming up, and I think I would have struggled with. Hopefully, I'll be able to handle now.
So that's how you think you're getting on. We're going to find out anyway. You know I'm with you all the way. I think I would like to do a bit of Slipping Around the Corner. It's all vital, this song, for you, because it's a characterization feel. I think you've been feeling that yourself, have you not?
Yeah, definitely. Feeling the character through the song, sensing every meaning now, yeah.
Yeah, well, let's come up there and do a bit of it, eh? Mm. Come on. This is a song by André Previn, and very good to get this characterization thing, the posh thing, remember? Mm-hmm. Together with the sort of throw in of the Cockney now and again, try and get them both together and away from any accent we already know. Yeah?
Right.
Okay. Men off the mail and off we go on tippy tail. Do do do. Peel a bleeding banana. Slipping around the corner, skipping around the corner, nipping around the corner, tipping around the corner, whipping around the corner, zipping around the corner, slipping around the corner with me.
Very good. That's really coming on. Really getting that sort of whole thing into the voice, the fun, the elan, the style, and you're becoming to use the words enormously. Now, I'm going to be rather devilish and take you back to olden days, a few weeks ago.
Long, long ago.
When we, in fact, were doing Les Miserables. So would you like to look at this?
No.
Do you see how far we've come?
God on high, hear my prayer. Hear my need. You have always been there. Here's
now, let's just see how we're progressing from there. Can we do a bit of that tonight?
God on high, hear my prayer. that have always been there. He is young, he is afraid. Let him rest, have him blessed.
It's very nice. You're getting a very good feel of words and things. A little terrifying, because of course the song soars so quickly. The first time, the very first time we ever sang this song, was a third lower.
Yeah.
I've taken you up and sort of put you into different sort of perspective of singing there. It's very tough, but I'm going to ask Drue to come and help us out. Do you need your glasses, Drue?
Yeah, I do.
Now, Drue has a very big voice. He's got a rather glamorous big voice. Drue is currently in Starlight Express. He plays Greaseball in Starlight Express. Here he has to scale his voice down. Can we try, Drew?
God on high, hear my prayer. In my name, you have always been there.
I would implore you, you have your own special person, your own special quality. You have a great relationship beginning. This word I'll use often, relationship, but here I mean working with words, working with nonce or phrase. And now I'm going to ask Drue to sing a very different type of song. It has its same feeling in a way because it's a big long line, a long legato line. Here you were with bring him home. And here we've got, if I loved you, the whole song. Now, this is one of the great songs by that Richard Rodgers and Hammerstein ever wrote from Carousel. And Drue here has got to be very good in his usage of words because he's trying to pretend to the girl. She said, but I don't love you, and he's saying, but if you did, and so then he says what he's going to say from the song here, but he's not got to be so specific at once. So here he's got a usage of word that's pretending he's not in love, and yet he's desperately in love, because we know they get together, if only for a short period, before all the terrible things happen in the story. So could I ask Drue to sing it, and I would ask you very carefully to watch again, all to do with style, Joe. To do with style, nothing to do with I'm getting up to sing a song. Mm-hmm. Yes? Lovely.
But somehow I can see just exactly how I'd be if I loved you. Time and again I would try to say all I'd want you to know. If I loved you, words wouldn't come in an easy way. Round in circles I'd go, longing to tell you, but afraid and shy, I'd let my golden chances pass me by. You would leave me, off you would go in the mist of day, never, never to know. If I
Lovely, thank you. And here, you can see how he has to husband the voice, this big voice, to deal with this very tender love story, this warm story. We'll be looking at you next week in Slipping Around the Corner, just for this elan of words. But meanwhile, I'm going to move on to my next student, Louise Weston. She's probably got the toughest job with O Mio Bambino Caro, an Italian aria, but it is one of the great pop arias of opera, you know.
Yeah, it's a nice tune.
Well, yes, it is, but, you know, this is to help you with R's and all sorts of things. You may have lived in Australia, but you've got a lazy R, and I've sort of tried to get the sound through so that you have much more detail and usage of word. Sharon just had to do the same. She was just your age when she took over Cassie at short notice in a chorus line at Drury Lane. And here she was having to do the same kind of program. She didn't sing the same song as you've sung, but I got her into Italian, French, all sorts of things, to try and get rid of this sort of tight feeling and this lifted up feeling of being afraid of using your words, using your mind when you sing. Mm. And so let's just see how O Mio Bambino Caro is getting along.
Okay.
I think we could pick that up maybe into Si Si Ci Voglio Andare, with that upbeat feel on the Ci Voglio Andare.
Okay.
Yes? Andare, is it?
Andare.
Andare. Come on, I'm not going to hit you. Andare.
Andare.
There we are.
Okay.
Yeah.
Si Si.
You do love, you know, it's that two in the bar that the Italians love to write. You have it, this cantabile, this. And so you've got to get this one, two, three, one, two, three, held in the bar and not let it droop down.
Mm-hmm.
But it's tremendously improved. You can hear that yourself.
Yeah, it's helping a lot.
Sharon, maybe you come and help a little bit with this.
I learnt this yesterday.
Sharon hasn't seen this before. But
really.
I'll let you into secret. Her mother's Italian. She used to be all right with the Italians.
Five generations ago.
And now, let's see if you can do Ma per buttar Milano, just that little bit, getting the R to run forward. Ma per buttar Milano. Let's do it together.
Ma per buttar Milano.
Maybe a more E vowel and a Minarno. Ma per buttar Milano, yes? So would you do that? Ma, yes?
Ma per buttar Milano.
Look how this girl holds herself when she sings. She's a princess when she sings. You are as well. Two Italian princesses. What can we want more? I hope that's helpful.
Mm.
But thank you very much, Sharon, for the moment. Good girl. Before we go into something else, I'm going to show you how you were singing How Can I Reason by Ian Wilson, the pop song that you're going to release later this year. And I know it's difficult circumstances here, and we're in this studio sense here, which is not the same as a recording studio by a million miles. But I know you're game. But we're going to look at this first.
Okay.
Can we?
What's going on? It's
like I'm trying to catch my shadow, and every time that I get close, it's gone. I ain't worried, just confused. I'm looking into a glass darkly, but all I ever see is you. What's this magic? What's this life? What's this rhythm in my life? How can I reason when the only reason why is you?
You're very rhythmic, but you went sort of together with those words.
I wasn't. I can't figure my shadow, and every time that I get close, it's gone. I ain't worried, just confused. I'm looking into a glass darkly, but all I ever see is you. What's this magic? What's this life? What's this rhythm in my life? How can I reason when the only reason why is you? What's this passion without pain? What's this rainbow with no rain? How can I read?
Very good. You can see it, one. As much as the shoulders are down. This is working. Pelvic floor is working. Everything's being a usage of words happening. You know, 90% of the pop singers we hear, and I've said this so often when I've been interviewed and things, you don't hear a word they're singing. You don't know what the song is, you just know the rhythm of the song.
Mm.
And the great pop singers like the Whitney Houstons and the Barbara Streisands, you hear their words.
Clear. Mm.
Well, they also have this wonderful graphic detail with the song.
Mm.
They deal with it. You're beginning to do just that. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Louise. Thanks. And really, it's getting along tremendously. And now I'm going to come to Frieda Rees. Frieda, I'll let you into a secret for those who weren't watching the program last week. Had a terrible cold, and she battled with it beautifully, and she was very, very tremendous, and she got through it. And she did what so many artists have to do when they go on stage. They've got to cope with difficult situations. And she became a real pro overnight. I'm really proud of her. But tonight, we're going to do a little bit of Half a Moment. Andrew Lloyd Webber's lovely song from Jeeves. Just to see how it's going. Now, can we pick this up, maybe, Janet, from where you had the pushing on the Pumosa section?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah?
Yeah, I can't.
And I think you've been finding, haven't you, that it's been really interesting from the point of view that you've been getting more range.
Yes, much more. And I've felt that I'm singing more from here. Rather, you know, you've told me to sing in the cathedral of sound.
That's it.
The phrase, isn't
it? Oh, yeah, yeah.
And I can feel it more there.
It's tremendous.
Definitely.
Lovely. Let's try.
Countless vivid memories spin before my view. Some toy kaleidoscope, images of you. Time looks kindly on fleeting lovers that can turn the briefest hour into a day.
It's really It's so interesting, Frieda, because all of a sudden you're not afraid to be part of the song. It's beginning more and more. You still have, you know, we can let them into a secret. You had a bit of a sibilant going on, and we've worked very hard at getting that together.
Yeah.
And I never point that out in the first place. We work on it and deal with it, and then the error has gone. But I would just like us to look just at how you were doing Lyndon Lee, the lovely song by Ray Vaughan Williams, just at the beginning of the program, can we?
Yeah.
You can bear it, can't you?
I can't stop you, can I?
Now, we're just going to go straight into it. This is becoming, but still there seems to be sometimes that you get tied up with the word going over. In Andrew Lloyd Webber's song, that's not happening nearly so much.
I feel as though I'm getting left behind and it's shooting on and I'm back here somewhere.
No, you're not. You're getting on beautifully, but remember to use your support. Can I call on Sharon Lee Hill here again? Sharon, dear, to just come, you don't know this, but again, now it's totally different. Yes, have you got some music there, but you don't know it? You don't mind being...
No.
We're off. Got to now relate those two together. What am I looking for when I look at Sharon? Can you see that, Frieda, yourself?
I don't know. Sharon's words seemed more definite.
Yes, and yet Sharon doesn't know them as well as you. But that's something that's going to come very, very quickly, Frieda. You all of a sudden have this tremendous openness about words all of a sudden. Mm-hmm. Now I'm going to ask Sharon to sing a very different type of song. It's a huge torch song. That's really a seduction song or a song that sells something. Now, if you watch carefully, she's got a whole being in this song. Her eyes tell the story. You have beautiful eyes, Frieda. You've got to start to sing with this part and not be so involved with the mouth. The mouth is wonderfully focused when it's a nice mouth as well. Look at you both, smile at one another. Look at that, that's perfect. Now. Sharon was in this show in Australia, Nine, by Murray Easton. She didn't sing this part, she sang a demure part, but here tonight, she's on the telephone to her lover. A call from the Vatican.
Who's not wearing any clothes? I'm not. You see